Parliament plus years on the industry side. And I think in these 14 years, indeed, when it comes to safer gambling, there are some trends. When it started, 2008, Italy and UK were the only countries in which online gambling was regulated. That triggered a process that in these 14 years led many other countries to do the same, initially across Europe, then US, Latin America, Canada, and it's still ongoing. Think of Eastern Europe, Ukraine. But still nowadays, the objective of regulators is absolutely the same as 14 years ago. The idea is to try to recover illegal gambling, to make some revenue and to control the sector. So it's a matter of trying to convince the operators to move from offshore to onshore. I still remember 14 years ago going with my suitcase to Stockholm Trent and speaking to Bet365, explaining the benefits of the internal license. But if that is the objective, the regulation must be viable, must be acceptable. Operators must be able to make profits, otherwise they will remain offshore. And so it can be too prescriptive. That will combine with the competition that the regulation brings, let's say, gives a little room to responsible gambling. Focus is growth, 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 and getting market shares. Think of the US now. It's a gold rush. There's no mention of safer gambling in the regulations, and there's no real commitment from the operator side. So that means that safer gambling is left as a principle often, not a prescription, and the initiative is left to the industry, which is again focused on growth. What happens next? You regulate, then because of regulation, gambling becomes very visible. Think of flooding of advertising, betting shops, gambling halls, slot machines, exhibitions. It's around us. This gives a feeling of pervasiveness that can lead to a negative perception from the public opinion. It's a sort of a backlash. It's fueled by media, who don't dislike emphasizing the bad stories, and then it affects the public opinion. And then think of Spain. I remember recently people went to the streets to protest against the betting shops. So that's the kind of reaction. So what can politicians do then? They respond to the public opinion, so they have to take action. What's the fastest, effective way? You impose some restrictions. Again, it's last 2 years we saw limitations in the maximum bets in the UK, advertising ban in Italy, maximum stake in Germany. That's the way policymakers react to the negative public opinion. But what happens next? These restrictions, while are good to generate consensus, are not so effective in protecting players. And that means that the policymakers have to introduce further restrictions in the future. So it's a sort of spiral that's affecting the industry and not solving the problem. So can we try to break this spiral? You know, all these restrictions and the operators' initiatives are focused on trying to protect the entire player base. You put a spending limit, so for everybody, regardless if they are at risk or if they are rich or not. Maybe the way we can try to break that before it's too late is to try to instead to focus on individual players. And that's another trend that is happening right now. You know, technology can help. There's a buzzword, artificial intelligence, but that can actually help identify risk in players in a very precise way. It can build behavioral profiles that are individual, and they can also explain why a player is at risk. In that way, we can intervene and try to keep players under control. So that would be a long story, but that's something we need to educate regulators about to avoid that they will put up restrictions in the future. And some regulators are already starting to understand that. We see the cases of Netherlands, Spain with the Royal Decree, France with their guidelines, Germany, Sweden, Denmark, and even Argentina. So maybe we have a chance to revert this trend and work a bit on the sustainability of the sector in the long term.